Hi everyone, and welcome back to the Johanna Konta podcast, your dose of relaxspiration, where we get to meet amazing people from the world of sport, business, entertainment, and just life in general. In this episode, I get to speak to Grand Slam champion and broadcasting legend Sue Barker. Sue had an incredible career as a professional tennis player, which saw her playing and competing at the highest level of the sport before transitioning into broadcasting. She would pave the way for those who followed as she changed the way sports broadcasting operated. You'll hear Sue's truly incredible story from her childhood through to her career on TV in this week's episode. So get ready, because this truly is an episode of Relaxspiration, and it's a good one. Hi Sue, welcome to my podcast. Thank you so much for coming on. It's so good to have you as a guest and to actually turn the tables a little bit to interview you rather than the other way around.
I know, I'm really looking forward to it. So I've been always, you know, I always love talking to you anyway, but this way around, it's going to be more fun for me, I think.
I know, more nerve-wracking for me. So we're actually recording this after spending a few evenings together over the last week broadcasting from Wimbledon without the tournament running, obviously, which I really, really enjoyed. Honestly, it's so incredible working with you. Oh. But obviously, you've been involved in Wimbledon broadcasting during the championship since 1993. I've actually done some research, so you'd be quite pleased. How did you find it this year, given that the tournament wasn't running?
It was really surreal. I've never felt anything quite like it. Having played there as a player, and then, as you said, joining the BBC in 1993 and doing it, it's always been a huge part of my summer. And then for this year, just not to have anything, it's just felt almost as like, just almost as everything's been cut off. You know, it's like I'm living in some sort of different world at the moment. And it's been really scary, hasn't it? I mean, reading the newspapers, watching the news and seeing how this coronavirus is affecting people and how we've had to adapt our lives in that way. It's just been really scary. And to lose Wimbledon was, you know, a small price to pay as far as everyone's health goes. But as far as just it being such an integral part of the British summer, it feels weird that we've had this whole few months without, you know, enjoying that. Because Wimbledon sort of transcends sport in a way, because I find that people that don't even watch a lot of tennis throughout the year just always want to watch Wimbledon. Wimbledon is something that people just enjoy watching, even if they don't know how to score tennis, they don't know who's playing the game. It's just such a big part of everyone's summer. People just stop to watch Wimbledon. So it's been a very, very strange few weeks, but you know, hopefully we're getting through the worst.
No, exactly, for sure. I know what you mean exactly, because for right now as a player, it definitely feels like I'm maybe, should I be in pre-season currently? Is it actually really June and July? Is it really this part of the year? It's a very strange, it was actually very strange. And I guess also because the weather wasn't massively good when we were doing the filming just now at Wimbledon, it did kind of feel like, oh, are we actually filming this in October? Are we actually just waiting for 2020 to begin?
I know, it was absolutely freezing. And because I live in the Cotswolds, I just sort of packed up a wardrobe and took it down there. And I was not dressed appropriately. I was absolutely freezing every night. And sitting alongside Tim Henman, who's on the committee at Wimbledon, he said, we would have played the middle Sunday. We would have gone into the third week. You know, the players wouldn't have liked it, because, you know, it was like winter. You're absolutely right. It felt like October. But I mean, I feel so sorry for you guys, for the players, because it's like, what do you do? You've got huge decisions to make. So, you know.
Well, I mean, I think it's like with everyone right now, there's just so much uncertainty, and obviously tennis and our work and our lives as tennis players is not exempt from that. And I think it's just, it's right now the whole world is feeling the uncertainty of what's next, how are we going to move on, continue, hopefully thrive again once again in the future, and yeah, just to work through this. But no, for sure. It's very, very strange times.
I just feel, you know, you just feel now that, I went to a restaurant the other night and, you know, I'm starting to go out and about. The normality of life is beginning to sort of creep back in. And I just hope we haven't gone too soon. But you really do hope that a vaccine will come in and life can get back to normal, because it just seems so strange for everybody at the moment.
No, for sure. And just one more thing on presenting. On, you've been presenting Question of Sport since 1997, which puts you on the leaderboard for one of the longest running UK TV presenters. Honestly, I'm in awe of you. But does it feel that long to you?
No, it doesn't, because everything, it just flies by. And yeah, I love presenting all the sport, but Question of Sport is just something that's so close to my heart. I grew up watching it as a kid. I used to be on it, you know, and watch with my family. So it's something that's always, always been very special to me. And I was really lucky, and I was really chuffed as well, because David Coleman, who was the great David Coleman, who sort of took me under his wing in some ways when I first started presenting, he was the presenter and had been for over 20 years, I think. And when he decided that, you know, he was going to give it up, he really wanted me, pushed for me to do it, because he knew that I love the program and I'd, you know, stay loyal to the program and want to do the program. And so to have someone like David Coleman sort of do that for me, it was really quite special. And we just have the best laugh. The boys are lovely, Matt Dawson and Phil Tufnell. And when we get into this, the green room with all the other athletes, it's so lovely to sit in a room with people from all different sports. And we all talk about, you know, different ways we approach sport, and we have a laugh, we tell stories. It's such a joyous sort of few days that.
Oh, that's so good. I definitely need to come on. I really want to come on.
I know, but you see, everyone's so competitive and they don't want to get a question wrong, and it puts the pressure on them, and we hate sort of putting the pressure on people, but we would love to have you on.
I was actually watching and I'm thinking, oh no, I really need to brush up on my sports pub quiz, because I'm a professional athlete, but I'm like the least knowledgeable athlete on sport that you probably ever find, so I need to up my game before I do.
Oh, I wouldn't worry about that, honestly. I wouldn't worry about that. It's all about having a laugh and having a bit of a good time, so it's fine.
But for many people, you're the sound of Wimbledon, and I think a lot of people will have grown up knowing you as a presenter. But you have had an amazing professional tennis career way before you started presenting. How does it feel looking back now at your tennis career after having such a successful move into another field?
You know, it's interesting. You know, this Wimbledon almost has brought it back to me, because it was quite strange when I was sitting there with you and Heather, and we were watching Chrissy and Martina play in the 70s, which is obviously my era. That was when I was playing alongside them, and seeing how different the game was and how it's changed. And even Chrissy said, oh, I hope they're speeding up our matches, because they always look so slow. It was a fabulous time to play. I absolutely loved it, and I love the people that I played alongside. You know, they're still my good friends today, which I don't think happens today, because everyone has a lot more people around them, whereas in our day we didn't. I mean, my coach didn't even travel with me, so I was literally on my own. So if I didn't go out to dinner with my fellow players, then it would be table for one, please. And I really didn't like that. So, you know, we've just became good friends because all of us just traveled on our own. And the game was so different. The rackets, I mean, we had wooden rackets, we had balls out of a tennis box. They weren't even, so it was a very different era. But you can only be, you know, play in the era that you're born into. But I felt like it was a very friendly time back then, because there wasn't all the pressures that you guys are under now. You know, you're under a lot more pressure. There's more prize money, there's the points, you know, there's more cameras pointing at you, there's bigger press conferences, there's more, you're more in demand than, you know, we could actually enjoy it. You know, our press conference would last maybe about 20-25 minutes, a couple of interviews, and off we go, you know. And it was lovely, whereas I see you guys, it's a full-time job, and it's at such a high intensity level that we didn't have that, which is why I've always said I'd never swap it, because I love the era that I was in. And then moving out of that into where I went was sort of unheard of, because there was no sports person that really went on to do that. I think when I joined, when I first started, the only other person who'd come from sport into presenting was former Arsenal goalkeeper Bob Wilson, who worked for the BBC. So it really was unheard of for someone to not to, you know, go through sort of journalism and go through working in a paper or radio to go in there. But you bring different sort of strengths to it. You know, you can bring the knowledge of sport into it, where obviously the journalists had maybe the better words and all that sort of stuff. So, you know, it was so different then. But now, it's almost like a lot of people that quit sport now, it's almost like open the doors, and it's you know, it's very common.
You're definitely a trailblazer, but I think what you've achieved, honestly, I admire you so much, because it's so much more than just specifically commentating on certain matches. It's more than just being a tennis commentator. You've really, like, there are people now who've grown up, like I said, who literally know you as a presenter.
Yes.
And they would need to do research to realize that actually you were an absolute bomb of a tennis player. You know what I mean? And I honestly, that is so, so inspiring to me, just the fact that you've literally reached the top of the game in two separate fields. So honestly, I really, really admire you for that.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Joe. I really appreciate that. But, you know, I've just been lucky. You know, I can tell you, I was lucky to have both. You need a lucky break to get where you get. And I had a lucky break to be born in Devon, in a Torbay in Devon. And there just happened to be a tennis coach in Torquay that had already coached French Open champion, Wimbledon semi-finalists. And he was looking for two players to sort of take on. And I was lucky. I was only the second one he chose, so I very nearly missed out. And my parents couldn't afford to pay for coaching. I was the youngest of three kids. And so he took me under his wing, and he never charged me. He only charged me £1 for the very first meeting I ever had with him, and he refused any money. And if it hadn't have been for him, I'd never have, you know, had my tennis career. And years later, when I was making money, I mean, not to the level that the players do today, but I was making good money, and I tried to give him money back. I said, I've got to, you know, I was earning like a couple of hundred thousand a year, which back in the 70s was huge. Yeah. And I said, I really want to pay you some money back for all that you did for me. So he reluctantly said, okay. So I gave him all this different money over like two or three years, and then I quit. And then I didn't realize that what happened is he'd gone to my father, and everything I'd given him, he'd got my father to invest for me. And so suddenly, like 10 years later, then 20 years later, and then 25 years later, these bonds suddenly appeared on a letter arrived on my doorstep. And there it was, that this money, I thought, where does this money come from? And it was, he invested the money that I'd given him. And so he ended up making me even more money. So,
I mean, that's incredible.
He was just the most wonderful man. And without him, I just wouldn't have been able to do it. And without tennis, then I wouldn't have had the second career either. So you just, it's sometimes just being in the right place at the right time and meeting the right people. And he was so, so special to me, and such an amazing coach. And
That's incredible. Yeah. I mean, it gets assumed a lot that you kind of make it on your own as an individual sport, but you 100% do not make it on your own in this sport, whether it's support of family, of a friend, of a coach, or there is always someone's in every player's career that gives them that opportunity to actually make it into a career.
Absolutely right. And sometimes you don't realize it until later on. I wasn't so sure. You know, I knew he was fabulous and that, but I just didn't realize how fabulous he was until later on. You know, he coached me for nothing. But then to do that, it was almost like he continued to want me to, you know, excel in life, and he didn't want the money. You know, it was just really just an incredible man. And then getting into television has just been such a joy, because you'll appreciate this. It's the you get that nervousness and the anticipation, and a bit like a tennis match, not the same, but a little bit like a tennis match when you're just about to go live on the air. So it, you know, I've been able to take what I learned from sport into that. It's controlling those nerves and, mm-hmm. and trying to deal with it and almost enjoying it, you know, to enjoy that pressure rather than be consumed by it. So I think that's what gives sports people have an advantage in that, because they're so used to being on that the big stage and having to deliver on the big stage and those sort of you know, that's required also in television presenting as well. So it gave me a sort of great kickstart into that area as well.
Oh no, for sure. And actually you said that you touched on that you grew up in Devon, and I grew up until I was about 13-14 I grew up on the northern beaches in Australia, so we both technically come from a beach life, and actually wanted to ask, what was it like growing up on the beaches in the UK?
Well, nothing like the beaches would have been where you are, I can tell you. I mean, I remember as a kid, I was obviously a very hardy soul. I mean, I used to go swimming almost all year. I can't even put my toe in the water now. I've become such a wimp at it. But it was fun, and I went to a fabulous school. I've still got friends that I went to school with are still my friends today, and we're on WhatsApp groups and all this sort of stuff. So it was a really, I think when you grow up not in a city, it almost becomes more friendly and more, everybody sort of knows everybody, and it's, you just, every time I go back now, because my mum is still living down in Torbay, and I go back down there, and there's people I've known sort of all my life, you know, that be able to get to know. And I think that's sort of, that's been nice as well, just that mm-hmm. sort of small town mentality
in
a way.
They
almost feel like family, you know. You mm-hmm. grow up and you become part of just that part of the world, you know, and everyone, they still seem to be there, you know. But I loved it. I was a real water baby. I used to love being in the water, so but now I live in the Cotswolds. I couldn't be more landlocked, but never mind.
So you mentioned school, and again, like I said, I'm going to keep mentioning this, I have done research. And according to Wikipedia, you went to a convent school.
Yes.
And I wanted to ask, is that, first of all, is that true? And what was it like for you as a child? And what memories do you have from that time?
Really happy memories, I've got to say, Jo. We went to a convent. I went to it mainly because my sister had gone to it. My sister was 6 years older than me, and my parents wanted us at the same school. It was a Catholic convent, although we weren't Catholic. But mm-hmm. It was a very small school. It only had, probably sounds bizarre now, but it was about 200 pupils, that's all.
Uh-huh.
And yet tennis and sport was such a huge part of this little school that we actually won, I think 3 years in a row, we won the tennis, the sort of nationwide tennis competition, beating schools like Millfield and all the major sports schools that had like 1,000 pupils in. We won it about 3 years in a row. And I think that was what was lovely, because I used to play hockey, netball, badminton for them, and tennis, and sport was such a huge part of it. And I think that's why I got to know everyone so well, because when you're involved in doing team sports and traveling together, playing matches at weekends, you become so close that that's why those friendships are still sort of really solid today, you know, because we had such a wonderful time. But it was fabulous to find a school that was so keen on sport. And I look at schools today and I see that sport has become less and less important, and I think it's so important, because not only exercise and everything, but I think it's about team bonding. It's about finding out about yourself a little bit and putting yourself in positions that maybe you don't want to be in.
It really helps. That's how trust is also built, I think, because when you are in those positions where you're vulnerable, or when there's the stresses come out, that's when you actually, like you said, get to know yourself, but then the people around you, and that's how you form lasting relationships. And I guess that's why, maybe, like you said earlier, right now, the way the tennis is, obviously individual players are more surrounded by their teams, but when you were playing, it was more your fellow competitors. You definitely need people around. No one's an island.
Absolutely.
So did you actually start playing at school then? So at what age, what age were you when you started playing?
Yeah, I actually started playing when I was 7, and I went to the Marist Convent, had a junior school and a senior school, and I was at the junior school. And again, it's having the right people around you. I had two PE teachers who were just so mad about tennis and mad about sport. And my junior school PE teacher made me do all these to get a diploma. You know, I had to hit the ball over the net 20 times in a row, you know, when you're 7, you know, but it was giving me these little goals to do, and I'd get a lovely certificate that I'd done it, you know, or I'd hit an overarm serve in 3 times in a row, something. It was just so special. But it was these women that did it that made me, you know, strive to want to be competitive and want to do this. And the PE teacher at the second school, at my senior school, I think every weekend she was taking us somewhere, because we did all these different sports and we were playing different events. And yet she was married with a kid. I thought, how did she ever spend any time with her family? Because almost every weekend we were off. But it's these special people that, you know, just cross your life in some way that make you the person you are. And without them, again, you know, I wouldn't have met my coach, Arthur Roberts, who then took me on, if these women hadn't given me the the sort of knowledge and the ability, because they obviously pushed me to be better. And so when Arthur Roberts came to select the two kids he wanted to take on, you know, to try and become international players, you know, I sort of stood out. Not I wasn't the number one pick, but at least I was the number two pick. But only because these women had you know, really taken me under their wing. So
I mean, by the time you were 16, you were actually ranked 21 in the world again. Done research. What was it like for you reaching such a high level of the sport at that age? And how did you know that you had the opportunity to become professional? When did you know you wanted to become a professional?
Well, it was such a weird time back then, because professional tennis only became professional when I was 12 years old. So all that time from 7 up to there, you know, there was no career. I wasn't ever playing tennis to look at it as a career. And even at the age of 14, I wasn't looking at it as a career, because there wasn't enough money in tennis really to be able to pay for you to travel the world and do these things. So I was really doing it just as a hobby. And then, of course, Billie Jean King broke away, formed the WTA, and then she had that match with Bobby Riggs. And by winning that, women's tennis just took off. And suddenly we were getting sponsors, we were getting things. And so I was playing a bit more. And suddenly, as you say, at 16, my ranking got to 21. And I had to make a decision. And my parents and my coach had to make a decision at 17. What do we do? You know, if I stayed in the UK, I would not be a professional tennis player. There just wasn't enough opportunity. The opportunity was in America, because that's where the sponsors were. The women had a tour all around America. So if I wanted to play, that's what I'd have to do. So it was I was desperate to go. And I look back on it, I realize what an amazing decision it was of my parents to let me, at the age of 17, I'd literally only passed my driving test 3 weeks before, to leave home, to leave them, go off on my own. My dad signed me with the Mark McCormick agency, IMG, and they set me up in a condo in Newport Beach, California. And I suddenly I got on the train at Paignton Station. I got on the train with my suitcase and my rackets, and that was it. I was going to be gone for like 3 years, because also back then, the tax implications in the UK were you'd pay 83% if you were paying over a certain amount. So I had to sign up. On my passport, it had stamped, I love this, alien. It had stamped alien on it. So I actually had no country. I could, and it meant if I was not allowed to come back to the UK for more than 63 days in a whole year. And with Wimbledon and Eastbourne and Whiteman Cup that we had then, it gave me very little time to see my family. So,
Oh my goodness,
I didn't actually get back to Devon for 3 years, but and my family couldn't really afford to travel. So it was really letter writing and phone calls for 3 years. So it was a really big, big step to take, but I was so desperate to do it, and I don't regret it. I had a fabulous time, but at 17 years of age, getting on a jet to America and renting a car, driving down to my own condo in Newport Beach, having just left my family house where I was sharing a bedroom with my older sister, it was like I thought I've cracked it, you know. So
this is like a Hollywood film that I'm listening to. It's like a script. I mean, I have Jackson here next to me, like tearing up.
tell me, I was in heaven. I thought this is the best thing, and then the next minute Rod Laver was down there and he said, "Do you fancy a hit?" And I'm like, "Hold on a minute, this is just so real." This unbelievable Wimbledon champion is asking me for a hit. I'm like, "Whoa!" You know, what I didn't realize was dear old Rod, he'd retired from tennis, and he started playing exhibitions. So he always told me later, we had a joke about it. He said, "I always started with you as the bottom rung of the ladder," and so. And then he'd work up to play the men players up there and all that. So but I said I didn't care what rung I was on, as long as I was on the ladder, it didn't matter to me, you know. To actually hit with Rod Laver was just incredible, having watched him from my front room as a kid, you know. It was it was fabulous times.
And then you actually went on to reach your first Grand Slam semi-final at the Australian Open, like me, in 1975. What was that for you, like the first time you reached the last four of a slam?
It was, I love playing in Australia. I love the energy. I love the crowds. And the courts were a bit firmer than they were at Wimbledon because it was on grass back then. And it was, you know, Grand Slams is something you've always grown up watching and wanting to be a part of. And I think I was almost too young to enjoy it. You know, I felt, wow, you know, it. I think looking back on it, you know, it got better as it went along, you know. So but it was incredible, because rankings are important, but it's where you finish at the Grand Slams. It's sort of, I think you look back on those moments as being the biggest moments in your career, and any of those Grand Slam events, even the ones that I lost that I should have won, I still look back and I think, you know, that it doesn't matter. You know, you learn from every, you know, you almost learn more from losses than you ever do from wins, and you move on and you learn from it, and they're all special occasions. It doesn't matter, you know. Even though John McEnroe always wants to have a go at me at Wimbledon and wind me up a little bit, it doesn't matter.
we're not bitter about it, Sue. We're not bitter.
No, not bitter. You can still do something about it. I've got no chance.
And then obviously a year later, in 1976, you became a Grand Slam champion at the French Open. Yeah. I haven't had the pleasure yet, of hopefully achieving something like that myself. So can you please tell me, what was that like?
Well, it was incredibly nerve-wracking, is all. I can't imagine what Andy Murray went through at Wimbledon, knowing the nerves I went through at the French Open, you know, where it was so early, it wasn't even televised then, because the French Open wasn't televised until 1979, so another 3 years later. But I've got some footage of it, and I've got a load of photos of it. But I tell you what, I can remember almost every point of it. It was incredibly tense. I played a great first set, an absolute horror of a second set, and I just let it go. And then I just thought, and they had a 10-minute break at that point, and I just went to the locker room and said to myself, "Come, yeah, this is, you cannot let this go," and managed to talk myself and came out, played a great third set. But it was just, it was a dream come true. It was everything I ever wanted to do. I obviously wanted to win Wimbledon. That was the one that I'd set my heart on. But to win a Grand Slam was something that was a real ambition for me. And I look back at it, you know, with you know, such sort of treasured memories, really, because it was the realization of, you know, everything I'd worked for had just come together right there day.
Yeah. And I know we touched on this actually when I was last on with you. I think it was on the Thursday with Heather last week, doing the Wimbledon show. And we talked about the pressure of being a British player, especially at Wimbledon. What was that like for you back then as a British player playing at Wimbledon?
Do you know, I don't think I dealt with it very well. I'm looking back on it. There's things I could have done so much better. I let it get to me. I let it affect me. I didn't deal with it well. And yet I was at a time when Virginia was 3 in the world and I was 4 at that time when we, you know, Virginia won it. I got through to the semis. So we were both 3 and 4 in the world. I was seeded 4 at Wimbledon. And I just think I just let it get to me somehow, in the fact that it was almost, I felt I could win it. You know this, but better. And we didn't have any sports psychologists then. And I wish I had, because on that semi-finals day, Virginia was on first against Chrissy. And everyone thought Chrissy was going to win it, because Chrissy was like, Chris and Martina were head and shoulders above the rest. But Martina had gone out. So Chrissy was still there. And when Virginia beat Chrissy, I suddenly thought to myself, I can win this. And you'll know this. Every sports person knows it. The worst thing you can do is to look ahead. You've got to keep where you are. Yeah, stay in the moment, as we've heard it. Absolutely do that. Don't look too far ahead. It's, you know, just keep concentrating on the very next point. And I didn't. I was suddenly thinking, I've beaten Betty Stover 3 times this year. I'm 3-1 up against Virginia this year. I can win this. Mm-hmm. And I just let it get to me. And I look back on it and I'm not happy with myself about it, but you know, it's interesting.
It is only, I guess, human nature, and it's all about just trying to, I guess, learn the tools to cope with that, with those things. And for me as a player now, I've had a lot of run-ins with sports psychologists, a lot of work over the years, and it is obviously something that is very much more mainstream now. And I would say most tennis players, most athletes have worked and do work with a sports psychologist. Do you think then that is something that you wish you had when you were playing?
But nobody had it. Yeah. Nobody had it. I mean, I talked to Chrissy and Martina. That didn't come in for at least another decade.
Yeah.
You know, we didn't even have our coaches with us, let alone a sports psychologist. You know, so you really were sort of out on your own. But it does make me realize just how much the mental side of sport is almost more important than the physical side of it, because most people get themselves into physical shape where they can last the match. And, you know, if you're already up in the top 10, you're playing at a level that, you know, you should be able to beat everyone in it, you know, maybe not consistently, but you should be able to beat everyone in there. So it just shows that when it comes to those big moments on the big stage, that it's a lot more of how you approach it mentally rather than physically. I mean, you look at Djokovic, don't you, playing Federer last year with the crowd going crazy and 2 match points, and how mentally tough he was in that match, and how mentally tough he's been in so many matches. I look at him and I think, wow, that's what I need.
I think he's got an incredible record of winning matches from match point down. Like he's won some a ridiculous amount of matches like that, which is so interesting. I think he's really, I think, like, really leading the field with how many matches he's won from that position.
But how tough is that? I've never heard a crowd like that last year. You know, that it was almost louder than when Andy was playing. Yeah. Everyone wanted Roger to win it. And how he can just keep that calmness and play his best tennis there. I just think they're all outstanding. But for me, Djokovic mentally is just so, so tough. And now looking as though he could be the person that's going to have the most grand slams, because you'd be, you know, tough to bet against him, with Roger and Rafa at their best.
So here is some more, studying trivia for me during my research.
I'm very impressed.
I found a newspaper article from 1979. With the headline, "A Model Beauty That Sweet Sue," which is basically, which is an interview with you, which goes on to read, I quote, "Nowadays, Sue Barker looks more like a film star than Britain's great tennis hope. The change from Sweet Sue to Sexy Sue has been dramatic." Reading that now, I actually wanted to ask you, as someone who's been both in the media spotlight and worked in the media itself, especially as a female athlete, how have you seen the reporting of women in sport change?
I tell you, it was awful. It was awful back then. If you think you get hard done by now, trust me, back then, forget my headlines. Chrissy and I have talked about this so often, all the time. It was always about who she was dating, what she was wearing, where she was going. It was nothing to, you know, do with the great athlete that she was, you know, that always the front pages were always tabloid led, and it was really difficult to deal with, and I found it really uncomfortable. I've never liked being in the spotlight. I've never written a book. I don't go to film premieres. I don't go to different things. I like, even though I've got a high profile career, I choose to just do my career and then go home. I don't like to do a lot of the other stuff. So I found this really uncomfortable. But of course, we had no say then. There was no social media where you could go on and say, this is rubbish. I didn't say this. Da, da, da. Although that can open up a whole new can of worms, as I've seen. You know, I'm not saying social media is great, but at least you can have your own say. But back then, you could never have your own say.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's changed a lot. I think people are respected a lot more. I still think it's improving. I've seen how, you know, women are portrayed in my job now. There's way more people, you know, Claire Balding, Gabby Logan, Hazel Irvin. I'm just talking BBC people. Yes. Now, other networks as well. There are more and more opportunities, and they're respected broadcasters and journalists, and I think that's fabulous. And I feel it's changing in tennis and sport as well. I think there's much more respect rather than just gossip about female athletes, because that's sort of all it was back then, is they just love to have a headline that I found really quite distasteful. I mean, we were joking when we were at Wimbledon talking about, I mean, the dresses were short and the shorts were short for the men. It was all very different. But it wasn't because we chose to have them that way. It was the way, you know, if you signed with a label, that was what you were given. You know, we didn't choose to, oh, can you take it up 2 inches, please? You know, that was it. You know, everybody wore them.
Yeah, no, it's so interesting though, because right now there seems to be this misconception that because of the rise of social media, it's actually brought on this attention and pressure on, and media pressure on how women look, and all these kind of injustices that I guess we face through this new medium. But the wheel wasn't invented with this. It was already very much in motion. Yes. And it's just so interesting to hear you talk about it, because I mean, just reading that headline, I mean, I've had a fair few headlines, but nothing like that. Nothing like that. So it is so interesting to hear you talk about it and how you actually dealt with it then.
Oh, well, I'm not sure we did deal with it. It was just horrible. I think the only way I dealt with it is because I didn't live in this country. I could get on my plane and head back to California, and it didn't exist over there. I could be anonymous over there, you know, unless you walked into a tennis club in California, they didn't know who you were. So it was wonderful in a way. I could just turn my back on it. But you come over to Wimbledon, and every year it was a shock to the system to what they would write. But as I said, it wasn't just for me and for Virginia. It was also, you know, for Chrissy and for other people, Yvonne Goolagong the same. Headlines that you think, wow, you look back on them and you think it's just really, really upsetting, you know. But you're right, with social media, it seems to just upset so many people. I'm not sure I could deal with it. I'm not on social media. I don't want to be on social media. And I think the Instagram thing probably is okay, but you're right that even the Instagram, everyone has to look a certain way, you know, and hopefully that will change and people will just be happy with who they are and what they're doing. Just be happy in life, really, rather than the way they look.
Well, and try not to live life through your screen. I mean, for sure. I think there's a place, and obviously there is a massive necessity now in terms of how our world functions and the kind of opportunities that we get as professional athletes or influencers or you know, people who need a social media profile and following, but it, I guess as long as you do that according to your own values and you are comfortable in what you're doing, then there's nothing wrong. And obviously it's not a place to spew hate and to hide behind a screen while throwing abuse. It should be a respectful environment, which unfortunately not always is.
No, it isn't. But you're absolutely right. And these influencers and reading, I mean, there's so much money to be made of it now. And if that is your career path and you want to do it and you feel you can steer people in this direction, I'm all for it. You know, absolutely. It's just the nastiness and the, you know, how personal people get that, you know, just really upsets me. But I'm not sure we'll ever get away from that until these social media sites actually make people write their own name down so that they can't hide behind an alias.
We talk about this a lot at home because obviously I'm not the one that usually sifts through all the unpleasantries that come my way. I ask Jackson here to kind of go through all that nastiness, but it's true. Until people are forced to take accountability to actually what they say and what they write on there, then this is just going to continue. But like you said, if each person is only allowed to make one profile, and that profile has to be verified with a driver's license or a passport or national absolutely. ID, then it's absolutely fine. If you want to say that, then you are going to be held accountable. But you know what? Yep. If you want to say it, then say it. But you know, there's going to be a record of it, and it's not going to be this, you know, 566 fake accounts where you can just abuse different people at different times. And there's definitely, I wish there was more accountability, because I think that would change the tone of a lot of people.
Absolutely. I totally agree. And I think it would just make it fair, you know, fair. I just don't understand why people always want to be so nasty about people. Let's celebrate someone's success.
I think it's more a reflection on themselves.
Yes.
And we touched on this earlier, and you did speak about it and how you got your lucky break, but it can be hard for athletes to transition into careers outside of their sport. And you also spoke about, you know, experiences and life lessons as a player on the tour helping you to succeed in your media life. But what were the things that you really felt like you really were able to tangibly take from the court into your media?
I think it was mainly the being calm under pressure, because it's very easy when you get nervous to talk quicker and to panic into maybe what to say. It's about staying calm, thinking about what you say before you say it, trying to remember what you were trying to say. Because I work in TV, I don't work with autocue, because the majority of stuff I do is live anyway. So it's all about trying to remember the points I want to make, or how I want to introduce a certain event or something. And so it's just about being disciplined, making sure you've done all the right work before it. And I think that comes from tennis as well, is, you know, as long as you put in the practice and you know that you have the ability to do that, then you can deliver it at the time that matters. Whether you do or not is another thing, but you know you've done the hard work to be able to do that, and you're confident that you've done everything. But I think mainly it is just not being intimidated by the camera or being out on a big stage, like walking onto center court or something, because I did it as a player, so I'm not scared of doing that and not frightened of being in front of the camera. And also, I think most importantly, not being frightened to fail, always wanting to succeed, but not being scared to fail, because, you know, that happens and you get up and move on. You know, it doesn't eat me up. It doesn't bother me. If I've failed, okay, you know, I've learned from it. I won't do it. I'll try not to do it again. I won't do it again. but it's just about, you know, just doing the best you can. And as long as you walk away and think, I've done the best I can, then there's nothing more, you know, no matter what people think about you or write about you, as long as you feel you've done your best, then you walk away and you think that you know,
with your head held high,
I'm fine with it. Yeah, then I'm fine. You know, I'm happy, and really that's all that matters. I can't be who they want me to be, because this is who I am.
No,
so
for sure.
If it's not what you want, then I'm sorry, but you know, this is it.
And as someone who's seen you in action, I can honestly say that it's so incredible. I was watching you and how you keep going through the lines and kind of just, I can can see you just putting them back into your memory bank. And honestly, seeing you in action was a true, true privilege.
Well, I tell you, that was a whole new experience for me doing like a highlight show, because I'm not normally doing the daytime stuff. So I haven't done a highlight show since 2008. And I thought, and I found it really constricting, because I'm so used to just, you know, having long interviews and chatting away and doing stuff. And it's like, you've got 2 minutes here, you've got 2 minutes there. I'm like, oh no, you know. So, but yeah, it was quite constricting. But I absolutely love the job. It's given me the same buzz that I got from tennis, and that's, you know, that's been special. Because when I did quit, I'd never told anyone I was going to quit, and I quit at the Australian Open. And I'd already at this point bought a flat in Wimbledon.
Okay.
Because I'd moved back from California, because I knew I was quitting. And I flew home, and I remember I woke up the first morning and I thought, right, now what am I going to do? And I thought, I've got nothing to do. All right, who am I going to see? Oh no, I've got no one I know here. You know, because all my friends were on the tour, my family were living down in Devon. I was here in Wimbledon thinking, I don't know what I'm going to do today. And it was a real shock to the system to not have a purpose, because, you know, right the way from even the age of 10, you know, tennis had been my life, and I'm doing this today, and this is what I'm striving for, this is what I'm going for. And then boom, it just stopped, like, suddenly. And it was really, really scary. And it took me probably about 3 years before I got, you know, the real break that I sort of wanted to get and do that. But it was a scary time, because, you know, you suddenly think, what am I trained for? All I'm trained to do is go on a tennis court and do this. I've gone and done a lot of speaking with different people from different sports to say, you know, always have an idea of what you want to do. And, you know, because it's not for life, you know, the tennis career. It may make you a lot of money, but it's too young to give up at the age of. So you've got to have something that excites you, that makes you want to get up in the morning, that makes you want to go and do something and come home and feel like you've achieved something as well. So
no, for sure.
I would think it's important to have something like that.
100%. And you talking about how not having that fear to fail and that desire to just keep doing it, to try something, to try and succeed at something. I think that's obviously why you are so special, and why you've been able to do what you have done.
Well, I think, as I said, all you can do is do to the best of your ability, whatever that is. I mean, my motto, I mean, Billie Jean King always said, go for it. That was what she told all the kids. When we're in the 70s, you just got to go for it. Don't even think about it. Go for it, she used to say. And my sort of motto is just not having any regrets.
Yes.
I didn't want to, in like 10 or 20 years' time, think, I wonder what would have happened if I had gone to the BBC and tried out for that. You know, I just thought, I'm going to try everything. And if going back to what I said before is hoping going there to succeed, but not being afraid to fail. If you fail, then you say, okay, it's not for me, but at least I had a go. And at least in 10 years' time, I can look back on it and say, well, it wasn't for me, but at least now I know it wasn't for me.
Yeah.
I don't want to have any sort of regrets in my life of things that I missed out on. At least I tried them. So that's why I've had two fabulous careers, and I can't believe, you know, to be in charge of Wimbledon and question the sport and going to all the Olympics that I went to for, you know, 20 years. It's just been magical. It really has.
Well, honestly, Sue, on the note of no regrets, just go for it. I cannot thank you enough for coming on my podcast. It's honestly been an absolute honour.
Oh, I've really enjoyed it. It's been lovely to talk to you, and all the best for you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
All right. Thanks, Jo.
Thank you to everyone for listening to episode 4. Don't forget to check out the previous episodes, subscribe, leave a review, and follow me across social media at Johanna Konta. Or for puppy spam, more importantly puppy spam, follow my dog at Bono the Blue Dachshund. For those of you who follow me already, you may have seen me posting about my latest project, the Sniff Club, the logo for which was inspired by my dogs Bono and Gizmo. If you want to see how they became the inspiration behind the logo and to find out more, visit thesniffclub.co.uk. I hope you enjoyed listening to this episode as much as I did recording it. I truly believe Sue is my spirit animal. But in the meantime, I'll be back soon with more amazing guests. See you next time.